make it good.
All right. I learned over the week how to make things happen. So, make some stuff. So, welcome back to ethics and our ongoing study of difference between right and wrong in theory. The last week, you guys, we talked about religion and ethics and how they're connected. You guys did some readings, you did some writing about all of that. I responded to some of the, many of the short answer posts that I got. I threw back a comment here or there. If you didn't get a comment, then I was probably pretty happy with what you wrote. Obviously, I've not looked at your papers yet, which were due 2 minutes ago, so I've not yet looked over those. But does anybody have any questions about the stuff that we worked on yesterday, or the assignments that you worked on over the week, or any of the stuff that you wrote? Yeah.
Okay. The there were instructions in the writing instructions about putting word count on the paper.
Ideally, I mean, it just makes life easier for me if you put on the either at the very top of the first page or at the very bottom of the last page, word count.
Okay, but not per page.
No. Right. Just a total word count for the paper. I don't usually. I mean, usually I can tell if it's short. And then I do a little word count thing, but it's just a pain for me to have to do that for every paper and so on. So it's much easier if you guys just when you're done writing it, just do a good word count and throw it on there. In a perfect world, you would not include like your name and the class and my name in that word count. But if you're that close to the word limit, then it's not. We're already having some problems. So I'm not going to stress out about that.
At this point, we didn't put it on there.
Not today.
Okay.
Not today. Do please, I mean, I do have at the top of the page, of the class page, that little bit about that form about crucial information on writing a paper. Please do read this and take advantage of it. It is there for a reason, for many reasons, and it's not just because I'm picky. I put this up here because I fear that not enough of your professors do tell you exactly how to write an academic paper. And so this is something you can use in other classes and will make your professors happy for the rest of your lives. So I hope you read that. Other questions? Any questions about the religion part? Or mechanics of the class, technical stuff, that's fine too. One of the things I do want to talk about real quick in the Euthyphro passage. Goodness. Adobe is attacking. You'll note the question. Discuss the argument. I know this is a different view than you guys get, but discuss the argument made by Socrates that what is holy is what approved by the gods are not the same thing. You'll note that I'm specifically asking a question about a particular part of the paper, and I didn't want to kind of draw it, say, I'm asking about this particular piece because my fear is sometimes that if I do that, students only read that particular piece, or up to that piece, and they stop. And I don't want to do that. Here, I was intentionally not asking about the, is something good because God thinks it's good, or does God think it's good because it's good, piece. That is not actually the bit that I was addressing with this question. That was what most of you wrote about. If you did a decent job of that, if I could tell that you read carefully and paid attention to the thing, I was okay with your responses mostly. But one thing you want to be sure that you're very careful to do is to address the question being asked, always. Okay? One thing you definitely don't want to do, and this was something I tried really hard to call out whenever I saw it, because it's important that you are careful about this. What I didn't want, what I really didn't want, was just an overview of the thing, of the Euthyphro. Euthyphro is about how Socrates is questioning Euthyphro about his understanding of piety. That's all true, but that is not at all what I'm asking. And there's a we've got to make sure we're seeing a distinction between a synopsis of the reading and an answering of a specific question. Okay? So just as a something to keep in mind moving forward for further questions. When you see a question like this, make sure you understand what I'm asking. And ask me if you don't understand what I'm asking, and then only answer the question. That's all I want you to do. I mean, some of you guys wrote like 700 words in response to this, and that was like the paper length was 750, right? 500, 750. Some of you wrote hundreds and hundreds of words here, and I was really looking for like less than 100 words. So if you were up in the 600 word range, you went way beyond what I was looking for and probably did maybe answer the question, but certainly did more than answer the question. And honestly, might not have answered the question either, right? Number of words does not equate to a good answer. So what was I asking here? What is it when he says, when Socrates says that what is holy and what is approved by the gods are not the same thing, he gives a reason why. Does anybody remember why he says that?
It's not because all of the gods don't necessarily agree on one particular thing.
So that was exactly that, right? Gods themselves disagree, right? And this is obviously a very ancient Greek-specific discussion at this point, right? Because when, for most of the people in this room, I imagine monotheism is a thing, you don't really have to worry about the gods disagreeing. But the Greeks did. And they had to, right, there was that issue of gods not always liking the same thing, and so how do we decide, right, that this thing is holy if some gods like it and other gods don't? And then Euthyphro responds to that with what?
I'm probably not going to answer the question. But for me, both of the readings was like, it was hard to understand a little bit. And it was like going in circles. It was really difficult.
It can be challenging. It's one of the reasons I try to talk about the readings in advance, to give you at least some idea of what's going on before you pick up the paper. Remember that I am available for communication. Like, if you're really lost, shoot me an email. We can chat on Google Mail, right? Because we all have Gmail accounts. There are ways that we can talk between classes so that I can help you to deal with some of that. But a lot of what this is reading closely, reading carefully. And it can be hard to read a philosophical paper carefully, but we're exercising our brains so that we can get to that. Anybody? Is the first response, Crystal?
I'm not sure, but I think he said what they do all agree on. That's good. What they don't agree on.
That's right. Even Frodo's idea is, all right, well, let's say maybe there are some things, right? Bob, God A thinks this thing is cool, but God B doesn't. Maybe it's holy, maybe it's not, right? It kind of depends. One of them's probably wrong, right? But who knows? But we can say that the things that all the gods love, that's holy, right? That's going to work as our, right? So we might have to narrow a very small list of things that are good. But that's okay. At least we can go from there. And then Socrates goes on to point out that even if we do that, then we get into the problem of, okay, is it good because the gods like it, or do the gods like it because it's good? That's sort of his next step in the argument. But I was asking about the step before that. Okay. Typically, right, I'm going to give you guys, as we talk about readings and so on, I'm going to give you guys a broad outline of what the reading is about, sort of a general idea. But part of the function of this is to make sure that you read. And so I probably won't ask you about stuff that I specifically talked about in class. I'm gonna ask you about some sideways bits or some sides that maybe the reading is about, and that's intentional. Other questions about the religion thing? Are we all on board with it? We're not all on board with it, I know that. Right, based on your responses, some of high distance learning folks, some of the distance learning folks particularly, are not buying this whole separation between religion and ethics, which is okay. Everyone's entitled to their opinion. No, that's what we're going to talk about today. But I want to make sure that you guys understand why that's important for us, because there was at least one response online about sort of the confusion or the surprise that I'm trying to draw this distinction. Again, the overall point I'm trying to make is that if we're going to study ethics as an academic activity, right, we can't rely on religion for a variety of reasons to provide that ethical basis. We've talked about some of them, right? We've talked about Euthyphro, the problem in the Euthyphro, where even if we do try to rely on religion, it's not super clear that that's actually the most sort of fundamental source of the idea of good. We never even got really into the point that the sort of most obvious problem with using religion is that we don't all have the same religion. Right? And so it's really hard to establish, you know, resolution to conflict. I think it's okay to hit Matt with a bat, and Matt says, it's not okay to hit me with a bat, and I say, well, my religion says it's okay, and his religion says it's not okay, we're at an impasse, right? We can't solve that problem, right? Which we see, we sort of touched upon at the end of class last week, is one of the issues that we are having in the world today. My religion says this is a thing, my religion says it's not a thing, we're done with that conversation. There's no going beyond that. In order to solve that problem, we have to find a different, more fundamental, common ethical approach in order to determine whether it's right or wrong. And so that's why this is important, that we are distinguishing between ethics and religion. And they are different things. And again, it's just a really boring class if the whole time you just say, because my religion says so. Yeah, right? So there's also that piece. Yes? Any other questions about the religion thing before we move on? Today, we are going to talk about a slightly different thing a slightly different problem in ethics, in general. And that is the idea of relativism. The idea of relativism actually comes out of a non-philosophical tradition. It actually comes out of anthropology in the 19th century. Maybe as far back as the 18th century, certainly in the 19th century. There is this anthropological recognition, right? We've got missionaries traveling out from the Western world, and we've got or from Western civilization, we have anthropologists traveling to places all over the world. And of course, it was a very different time then. There are far more non-industrialized countries. The word primitive is still used to describe certain places in the world. And these anthropologists are traveling around to these different places, and they're noticing, wow, these places are really different. The cultures in these places are very different. The people in these places act very differently. And you can look at some of their cultural mores, which is just a fancy word, right? It's an R. Mores, that didn't help. Still not help. That's M-O-R-E-S. Mores. Or it's just a fancy word for their customs, right? The cultures that are appropriate for their custom are very strange to us, right? To the people, the anthropologists of the time. Very different, wide range of what is appropriate behavior and all places. And people are finding that in some cultures there are things like cannibalism, and in some cultures there are things like exposure of infants to the elements, and disposal of the elderly. Right? There reaches a point when the old people can't contribute anymore, and so they just send them off into the woods and say, good luck, Grandpa, and that's the deal. And so anthropologists are seeing this behavior and are recognizing that it's not just different, but accepted. It's normal in those cultures. It's obviously very different from the culture in which the anthropologists have come, but it's normal there. And so there becomes this pushback upon judgment. Right? We're not going to judge these cultures. We're not going to tell these guys who are cannibals, who eat their foes after battle, right? Like, that's wrong because we don't do it that way. We're going to look upon those folks and say, well, it's not the way we would do it, but all right, that's a way to get rid of your dead enemies. You got them, you can't just leave them lying there. You got to do something with them. So sure, eat them, why not? And we're not going to judge that. We're not going to claim that it is morally wrong. That ultimately turns into this idea of relativism. And so ultimately, the idea within relativism is this idea that the normal, whatever is normal in a society, is good. That is acceptable. And that the normal in one society may be very different than the normal in a different society, but they're both good in respect to their individual societies. So each society has essentially its own version of good and bad, right and wrong, good and evil, however you want to put it. Yeah. Thoughts? That's basically it, right? That's relativism. And this is all we're going to talk about today, so we might be done really early. We probably won't be done. This is all we're going to talk about today. How does that feel, that idea of relativism? How many people are in favor of relativism? That is, sort of, people do their thing, and we don't judge. We don't say they're wrong. Hey, Sean, Tracy's good. Yes, yes, we've got some very reluctant hands. Some people won't even raise an arm, just a hand. Like, you can sense the trick, right? I'm going to agree. Yes. Like, wait, he's only saying this because he wants me to say that I agree with him. He's going to say, no, you're wrong! I am going to say that, but in a little while. I'm going to take my time to get to that. It feels right, right? We have, for better or worse, over the time since that period, come to accept that as a sort of way of dealing with people, right? We shouldn't necessarily tell people that the way they do things is wrong. You shouldn't dress that way, or you shouldn't eat that food, or so on. Right? Classic, great example is certain Asian countries in which they eat dog. Right? And for whatever reason, in this country, that is considered just like, what? Like, somebody eats dogs? Like, I love my dog. Well, they're not eating your dog, right? They're eating different dogs. But people still, people freak out. But a relativist is gonna say, that's ridiculous. There's no reason to judge people for eating dog. That's just their culture. And it's totally normal in their culture to eat dog, just like it's totally normal in this culture to eat cow or chicken, and so relax, right? Stop with the whole judgment thing. And so I think we like that, right? People who are open-minded and thoughtful like to say, yeah, no, that makes sense. It's not the way I would do it, but it's all right. It's acceptable. And interestingly, we've even gone further than that over time, to the point where we are like sort of individually relativist. Like, I wouldn't paint my walls that color, but who am I to judge you, right? You can do that as much as you want. And I wouldn't raise my children that way, right? I wouldn't ever spank my child, but, you know, you can do what you want, because who am I to judge? Everybody's opinion is equally valid, sort of thing, right? Everyone is entitled to their opinion. It has become a statement that we sort of accept in this culture, and so we do, right? Value everybody's opinion, which is, right, the relativist is going to say, yeah, that is now part of our culture, that we accept that other people's opinions are different, but we don't hold them, we don't think less of them for that. We allow them, everybody to have an opinion, everybody has their own opinion, everybody's opinion is valuable. Which is an interesting thing. It's just this idea has sort of shot out into and expanded into something that I'm not sure that these anthropologists from the 19th century imagined it was going to be. Right? It's become a bigger thing. And some of that is about, tolerance. Well, tolerance is a big deal for this, but about sort of being understanding, being a little bit more multicultural, being willing to accept other people's behaviors a little bit more. In many ways, it's a really, really good thing. But in some ways, it can have some problems. Ultimately, the sort of defining characteristic of relativism is this idea that tolerance is a virtue. I mean, to be tolerant of other people, to tolerate their differences, is a good thing. It is that is part of, right, that our cultural idea, identity here around tolerance is that it is good, and therefore tolerance is normal, and therefore, right, we want it to be normal because it's good, or it is normal, and therefore it is good, kind of however you want it, whichever direction you want to go in. Normal and good are the same thing, and tolerance is that. And it is both normal and good. Questions? This is hopefully nothing too shocking, right? It's pretty straightforward ideas here that we have about wanting to be understanding and tolerant. Now, we should really quickly take a step back. I kind of skipped over one thing, but I want to make sure that we understand the difference between cultural relativism and what's called normative or ethical relativism. They're both relativism. Both of these two things are versions of, forms of relativism. And I should have started with this, so I'm kind of rewinding a little bit. Cultural relativism is simply observing the fact. Right? This is what one sort of cultural relativism leads to normative relativism. So the idea that the first thing that happened was that these anthropologists went and noticed that things were different. Right? They had to go to these different cultures and say, wow, they really have a different approach to the relationships between parents and children, or between the elderly in society, or between the dead, right? Different cultures, different ways that they dispose of the dead. There's a great story about Darius, king of the Persians, right? Way back in a long time ago, 300 BC, and he's got some neighbors who are from Greece, and he's got some neighbors who are from India, and he gets them together. And he's talking about how they dispose of the dead, and the Greeks, they cremate their dead, and these folks from a little section of what is now India, they actually eat their dead. And Darius asks the Greeks, like, how much money would I have to give you for you to start eating your dead instead of burning them? And they're like, there is no amount of money. We would never eat our elders and our ancestors. That's horrible. And he goes to the Indians, he's like, so how much money would I have to give you guys to get you to burn your dead? And they are shocked at the very idea that someone would burn up and turn to ash their venerated, beloved elders whom they eat to honor. So this idea that they're, that this, just the perception, the first thing is just recognizing that they're not necessarily, neither one of those is necessarily right or wrong, but they're just different. And certainly, and they're both different from Darius, who in the Persians, they buried their. So three different ways to approach this same issue, and that's just a function of noticing that there are differences. And then the normative or the ethical relativism is saying, and that's good for them. That is good. That establishes for each culture, that normal establishes what is good. So one is simply descriptive. The other one is establishing an ought or a should, which is what normative means, right? Establishing the idea of you should do this thing or you ought to do this thing. And so I kind of hopped over a bit there, straight to the ethics a little bit, and I should have talked about the normative or the descriptive for that. So that's basically relativism. Usually there are questions. This is going way faster than I used to. Is everybody still on board with this being a good thing? I mean, there were only about half of the hands before, but everybody's still comfortable with this. Crystal, is that a question?
Just to make sure I'm getting it.
Yep.
So the first one, cultural,
yeah,
is noticing there are differences.
Yeah.
And the normative is kind of like accepting that it's okay that they're different.
Not just accepting that it's okay that they're different, but establishing that for them, that is the good. Right, and that the good for my culture and the good for your culture, say, are going to be different, and that's okay.
Okay.
Right? That you're actually creating the good via establishing the normal. Yeah. So.
With cultural, when you said observing the fact,
uh-huh,
is that observing the fact that you actually experienced it, or it being told and you knowing it?
Yeah, I mean, people, you know, we're going back here through history, and so it's kind of tricky. There are always stories from far off lands, right?
I take it as observing and experience.
To a certain extent, yeah. Experiencing it from a sort of a scientific and anthropological lens, as opposed to just like, these sailors came back and they told a story of mermaids. And, yeah. So as part of that, and as part of, I think, the idea of just being coming to grips with the idea that the people that they were going to observe weren't underdeveloped or savages or whatever, that they just did things differently. And that was just a different approach to whatever it is that they were trying to accomplish. And that's where it really becomes sort of the scientific element of anthropology, rather than just sort of like, look, those people are different. Does that make sense?
So again, cultural perspective, just noticing it, but not necessarily accepting it.
Yeah, so the cultural relativism is about identifying the fact that people do things differently in different places, and that different things are normal.
But not a judgment.
Right. And then the ethical relativism comes in when we establish that for that normal, for them, that normal is the same thing as the good, and that your good is different than my good, and that ought to be the way it is. It's establishing a should word to it. It ought not to be that way.
So I could be, from a cultural relativism lens, I could look and say, oh, that's different, but I can also say it's wrong.
Sure.
But in the normative sense, I can say that's different, but that's their norm, so that's their good.
That's right, okay, that's right. You're really making a claim. What you're really saying is, I am not in a position to judge other people's.
Mm-hmm.
That's really what the ethical relativism is to say. I can see other people's cultures, I can observe and study and all of those things, but what I cannot do is judge. I cannot say that those people are right or wrong. And that's the ethical statement tied into ethical relativism. Yeah? What are the problems? I wouldn't bring it up if there aren't problems. There are problems.
A lot of problems.
Crystal.
One would be like murder.
What about murder?
Because like the majority of people would say that's bad.
yeah, it depends kind of on your definition of murder. Right.
I talked about that in my paper a little bit. How it just depends, because technically murder would be you taking life to someone else. There are so many things that come into play there.
Yeah, which we see legally, right? The difference between degrees of murder and manslaughter and accidental homicide and all those sorts of things.
So wouldn't that be to kill instead of murder?
Well, but sometimes it's okay, right?
But to murder would be unconscious. But normally to take a life or whatever. Kill is to just take a life.
But sometimes it's not okay, even if you don't know about it, right? Like if you're negligent and you leave a pit out in your yard.
That's why I said to take a life.
But sometimes it's okay to take a life. Right, as self-defense. Right, we've got to figure out a bit. Some. I think it's trickier than a simple, just like, yeah, that's part of the problem. But I think Crystal's point is that you think that that's a universal thing, right? We shouldn't be killing people. And everybody agrees with that. And so isn't that a count against relativism? Or am I putting words in?
No, it's something like that. I just can't say everybody, because I know there are some people who find it okay.
Yeah, it wouldn't be hard at all to find some people who think it's okay. And that's the problem, right? There are cultures, we go not so long ago, you go to the China and the one child laws, and right, if you give birth to a girl, well, that we've got to deal with that. And that's killing. Or an Eskimo society had a similar issue not very long ago, where they would, if you had a baby girl, they would just leave it outside, and nature would take its course, and that would be the end of that baby. elderly, right? Lots of cultures where the old themselves, I mean, they sort of are, they get to make the decision, like, all right, I can't really help anymore in this culture, in the society, in the whatever the family unit is, so I'm going to go wander off into the woods now and get eaten by a bear or starve or something like that, because I'm, because that's, it's time for them. And everybody says, all right, great, you know, like, we're going to wish you farewell and good luck, right? I mean, so you don't have to go look super hard to see cultures where killing is sometimes seen as okay, right, depending on the situation, right? Even more so than just in self-defense, right?
Right.
So that's, yeah. Chelsea. In some states.
Yeah.
Yeah.
In some states.
Yeah.
That's a question that I have to ask. Well, I have to ask a question that is similar or touches on that kind of work. Are you being forced to have introverts? Are you able to say no, we don't want to have introverts? And someone would be like, no.
Yeah.
Well.
Right. So, to sort of generalize what I think you're saying, and correct me if I'm wrong here, but the idea is, what do you do when two different cultures come into conflict about anything? If it is, we can use that example. If a person from a culture in which there's really no such thing as marital rape, once you've signed up to be married, then you are considered ready to go at all times, then were to come to a state where that's not legal, how do we, or shouldn't say just not legal, but not to a culture where that's not considered ethical, then how do we resolve that? Because you can probably imagine the discussion that's going to happen. It's a lot like that religion discussion I was talking about a few minutes ago. You know, I don't believe this is right. Well, I do. And then we're done.
Would that be a case of the societal rules applying? So if you're in the country that allows it, then you have no choice but to not stand against it, but if those people, that couple comes here, mm-hmm. then we have laws, then they're subject to our laws, despite their beliefs.
That would be one way to potentially solve it, at least practically, although one could argue that what if you do it the other way around? I think we're pretty unhappy with that result, right? Where, you know, you're from Connecticut and you go to some place where there's no such thing as marital rape, and you're like, well, I just have to, right? Sorry, wife, you just have to accept it because this is where we live now. That's right. I don't know that that resolves the actual problem. It maybe resolves the legal issues, but from an ethical standpoint, we haven't really solved anything. We've just kind of punted it. And actually, I'm going to come back to that very point when I talk about the majority and how we establish relativist ethics at all. And that's going to be another problem. But so remind me, because I forget. Somebody else had a hand.
I did. I was just going to say that would be one of the issues with ethical relativism.
What would be?
That, what would you do with what they were used to being okay, then they came here and it's no longer seen by us as okay. Are they still, do you punish them or do you not? Because the idea of that is that we may not agree with it, but it's okay.
Yeah.
And even
Well, and not just okay, right? It is for them, right? It is good. It is the correct thing to do. In fact, not doing that is wrong, right? For that culture. So it's more than just, it's okay, we'll let it fly. It's acknowledging that for them, that is the right action. Chelsea, were you going to add something? Sure, but lots of things cause conflict. I mean, I'm supporting conflict. I'm not a fan of conflict, but sometimes we're going to have to, right? It, one of the things about ethics is that sometimes you're going to come across things and you're like, that's not right. And you could just say, well, you know, I just check. I've acknowledged that's not right, and good luck, right? Or you can try and address it, and that's going to cause conflict, right? So, so conflict's not always the worst thing in the world. And we've talked a little bit about sort of like individuals coming into other cultures where there could be issues, but imagine conflicts between entire cultures, right? How does that get resolved? Particularly, I mean, in terms of, you know, in our culture, it is considered appropriate to try to expand, take land and, you know, resources and so on. And another culture maybe says, in all our culture, it's not cool to take stuff, and that's ours, right? And you're... And there's, if right between, there's if there's no intercultural rule set, then there's no way to resolve that. Right? So we get into these problems of trying to fix problems that don't have solutions because we don't have a baseline to use as right and wrong. One of the sort of consequences of ethical relativism, if we draw it out a little bit further to its sort of logical conclusion, is obvious. Right? The first half of the sentence is that, right, there can be no criticism of other cultures. And a lot of people say, yeah, that's a good thing. That's awesome, right? We're not criticizing other cultures, we're not judging them, we're letting everybody kind of, you know, do their own thing. As long as they're not, you know, messing with us, we'll even add that little caveat. And so it's great that we don't criticize. But the flip side of that coin is that neither can we praise. If we aren't willing to say that the things that that culture does, say the leaving the babies out, the Eskimo thing, right? And put the babies out in the cold because they're girls. If we can't say that that's wrong, and we criticize that culture for that behavior, then neither can we say, hey, you guys have a really good way of handling this problem, because, well, it's not really good either, right? If what they do isn't bad from our perspective, then it can't be good from our perspective either. We can have no real opinions about other cultures in any way, good or bad. And yet, I think we want to sometimes praise other cultures. We want to say, wow, that was the right way to handle that, or you guys have a really interesting way of handling this issue. Our culture might learn from your culture. But instead, we have to say, no, that's just the way they do things, and we don't have opinions about that, not either good or bad. It's maybe not the biggest problem in the world, but it's a problem. It's not awesome.
So you mean you don't voice or praise your criticism, voicing and criticism or praise if they're not going to have it?
Well, you know, I'm going to get to that in a second when I talk about tolerance as a universal value. I think the idea is not just that you're like, I disagree with you, but I'm just not going to say anything, like my mom, right? Where you're like, oh, you know, like, so what are you going for vacation? You know, well, I'm going to Disney. All right, you know, I'm not going to tell you that's a horrible mistake, you should come visit me, but I'm thinking it, right? I don't think that's what we're going for relativism, where we're just like, we're going to have all of our opinions, we're just not going to say them. It really is this idea that we don't judge you at all in any way, like in our minds of like, you're wrong to do that, right? When I was studying this back, this, I don't know why this always stuck in my mind. It's hard to do for reasons like this. Like when I was reading this, I was reading about this called this thing back in ancient Japan, right? In feudal Japan. And the samurais are walking around in their cool samurai armor, and they've got their really sharp swords, and when they get a new sword, they have to make sure that it's sharp enough to do the things they need to do. And so they had this thing that was called the crosscut test, and what they would do is they'd walk down some road, and some peasant or normal guy would come walking up, and they'd draw their swords, and they'd cut them in half, just to make sure they could, all in one slice. Right? If the sword was sharp enough to get all the way through the peasant in one shot, it was sharp enough. And it wasn't, well, the peasant died, you know, horribly, but at least I know I need to go sharpen my sword. And that's horrible. I'm thinking, right, that's a horrible thing. It would be a horrible thing to live in that culture as a peasant, right, which most people were, right? And to know that at any given moment, a samurai could show up and cut you in half, or someone you know or love in half. And yes, right, the relativist says, well, you know, it's just the way it was. That was their culture. That was their, they all sort of signed on for that in part as part of being that culture. And so we can't, we literally cannot judge them. We can, we not just, we're not going to say we don't judge them, we just don't. That was just the way they were, and that was right for them, and it was good. That was the good, that was the right way to live for those people. Going back to our good friend Socrates, speaking of, I mean.
I have a question.
Oh yeah, go.
So, we should not judge, because that's good for them.
That's what, just so we're clear, that's what relativism says. That's not necessarily what I'm saying.
So,
yes.
Her relative, can we, if correct, can we give suggestions? Can we make corrections?
No.
Just
no.
Leave.
Okay. Not from the outside.
From the outside.
Not from the outside. So, a really good example of this, that isn't maybe super obvious, that's not a great example, is our buddy Socrates again. We're going to go back to Socrates. I know you guys love Socrates. Socrates, we know, right, he's on his way to his trial when the Euthyphro happens, right, he bumps into Euthyphro and he has a whole conversation about piety and holiness and da da da. And then right after that, he goes to actually stand on trial, and he gives his defense, and I talked about this a little bit, the apology, and he explains why he does all the philosophizing that he does, and then the court finds him guilty, and then he has to come up with his own sort of like punishment, because in ancient Greece, right, the defendant came up with a punishment, and the prosecution came up with a punishment, and the jury picked one. So everybody was kind of encouraged to aim towards the middle, because if you picked a crazy punishment, then they would just pick the other guys, right? So you wanted to pick something kind of, you know, moderate, brought everybody in the middle. But the prosecution picks execution, and Socrates picks, you should pay me to live and give me free meals for the rest of my life. Right? That's his suggestion for his sentence for being found guilty. Obviously, the jury didn't like that, so they go the other direction, they go with execution. So he's ordered to drink the hemlock. But before he does that, just so happens that there's this religious thing, there's a boat, I can't even remember exactly the deal with the boat. The boat is on a trip, and nobody can die while the boat is away. No executions are held until the boat has returned from its religiously significant journey. So, Socrates is kept in prison for a few weeks, in which other things happen. There are some other dialogues Plato writes about the time that Socrates is in prison, which are pretty interesting. I recommend them. But the best one, is called the Crito. They're usually named after people, the dialogues of Plato. And Crito is named after this guy, Crito, who is a friend of Socrates, who sneaks into the prison under cover of darkness and says, come on, Socrates, let's get out of here. You've read the Crito. It's so good. It's such a good one. Because it's really fascinating. And unlike the Euthyphro, there's no circles. It's pretty straightforward. Crito sneaks in and says, come on, Socrates, let's get out of here, man. Like, they're going to kill you, and I've bribed the guards, and I've got a getaway boat, and you can just leave town and go to, who knows, you can go to Sparta, you can go to somewhere else. Get out of Athens and live, and it'll be great. And Socrates says no, and he won't go. And he gives a great big long explanation for why he won't. And part of that argument for why he will not leave Athens is because he has signed on for Athens. He has agreed to live there according to the rules of Athens, according to the customs and the laws and so on. And he gives this big argument. He sort of pretends to be the laws of Athens and talks to Crito and said, wow, what a jerk Socrates would be if, after years of living in Athens and benefiting from our order and law and protection and so on, he were to then turn around and say, and laws, you were wrong the whole time, I'm out of here, as soon as we say something he disagrees with. Now, it turns out that it's his execution, and so he strongly disagrees, but that's not the point, right? He has benefited from all of this stuff. His parents have benefited from all of this stuff living in Athens, and so he doesn't get to just disregard those rules. Now, he could argue with the rules within this, right, from within in the way that it's set. Like, if he really disagreed with the rules of Athens, he could have long ago tried to change the rules, right? Tried to change the legal system so that people couldn't be executed in such or such way for such and such an offense or something like that. But he can't. What he can't do is simply, you know, opt out now that the consequences have turned against him, because that's cheating, right? That's disregarding everything he's gotten out of it. And so, to a certain extent, I mean, that's a very extreme example of relativism, but it's along the same lines. It's this idea that these rules are right because they are the rules of the place and the time. Right? Does that make sense? And so, nobody can say otherwise, because we've all agreed that these are going to be the rules. And maybe, you know, 2,000 years later, we can look at them and say, oh, that's a totally bogus thing. But those were the rules and the culture and the mores of the time. I feel like I lost a lot of you right there. I was doing a lot of talking, a lot of people got lost interest while I was talking about that. But I don't know if that, Stan, I don't know if that makes sense, right? My point of bringing that whole thing up was, Socrates, as a member of that culture, can say, hey, I don't like this thing that we have going on. I'm going to try and change it. And that's okay. But for some Spartan to come in, for example, and say, hey, your system is stupid, that's not acceptable to Socrates. He's going to say, no, this is the way it works here. This is right. And you might disagree, but that's your thing. That's your culture. You do it the way you do it. This is how we do it here. And to the point, right, he believed that so strongly that he allowed himself to be executed because he believed in following the laws as they had been established. I just love talking about the Crito. I think it's one of the best things that's ever been written. And I encourage everybody to read it at least once in your life. So, we're still talking about issues with relativism. We talked about the fact that, so, again, we can neither criticize nor praise other cultures because we're just not supposed to have any opinion about them. And so, when things are good or bad, we're out of luck. One of the other problems with this idea is based around the idea of normal. What do we mean by normal? What does the word normal mean? Standard for the culture, but what does that mean?
Acceptable. Like,
it's acceptable. Well, I think that's what good means, actually, right? Acceptable is we accept something because we think that it's okay, it's not wrong. I think that's what good means. Normal, I think, means something slightly different. What's that, Joseph? Appropriate? Well, I think you're kind of in the same area there. I think in English we've kind of established two meanings of the word normal. One of them is that idea of, like, it doesn't offend anyone, right, is normal. But there's a more sort of fundamental idea of the word normal.
What's agreed upon? What are the standards that are agreed upon?
Agreed upon by whom?
The masses. The culture.
Everybody?
The majority.
The majority.
Ah, yeah, right, the majority. Tyler, is that right?
Everybody here has on some form of footwear.
Okay. And that is,
if one of us came in here without footwear, that would not be normal.
That would not be normal. Exactly.
Because most everybody, when I say most everybody, like, at least 90% of people in our culture wear shoes.
Right.
I mean, when we raise our children, first thing we do is, as soon as their feet, whatever, we get them some shoes. Should have shoes.
Sure.
You know, at home you can go barefoot, but when we go wherever.
So you're really modifying. It's not that we wear shoes, it's that we wear shoes outdoors, or
yes,
in the world, unless you're on the beach, right? We start modifying things,
right.
Because
it's good, but it's not.
Well, what's good but not normal?
So it's good to wear shoes at the beach. I mean, you know,
is it?
Yes, like
sand them.
I mean, like the beach shoes,
sandals,
flip flops. We designed shoes.
I see.
To wear
yes, yes. We developed, right, to get around the problem of getting sand in our shoes.
Right.
We, smart monkeys that we are, have come up with
shoes
ways around
that dirt can't stay.
Way to go. Sure. Yes. It's normal to wear shoeting. Shoeting. I just made up a word. It makes sense, right? If you've got clothing, you should have shoeling. It is normal in our culture to wear shoes. And again, normal, but what we mean by normal is that most people do it, right? The majority of people do something. That becomes normal. Now, are we willing to accept that what most people do is always right, good? Or, and maybe not just always do, but maybe what most people think or what most people support is always right or good. Are we comfortable with that idea? Chelsea says no. I don't think we have to go super far to come up with some examples of that being not good, right? And in this culture, historically and then in the present, the majority isn't always right about, well, and so we have to be careful here, right? The majority is right in terms of the culture, right? The culture of a society is, by and large, determined by the majority of the people in that culture. The problem is, I don't think we're always comfortable saying that what that is good or right, right? Our internal sense of what is right and wrong, right? We have conflicting ideas. Well, I shouldn't say we, right? Individuals certainly can be sort of, you know, overwhelmed by the majority, as we know. Majority outweighs individuals, but that doesn't mean that these guys are wrong. As we have seen over and over again in history, sometimes the minority, the individual, is right, and the majority is wrong. And we've sometimes corrected things that the majority felt, but not always. And so the idea that we're just going to do whatever the majority thinks, we're going to establish that as right, that seems like it might be a problem, or at least it conflicts with maybe an internal sense of what is right and wrong. Yes? Does anybody disagree with me? I think we are largely in the United States programmed to worry about the majority. A lot of the things that are built into our culture and certainly into our political system are intended to protect the minority from the majority. That's where things like the entire Bill of Rights is based around the idea of we have to make sure that a small number of people can still stand up against a large number. So this is an important thing for our culture.
It's interesting how you navigated that whole thing.
Which whole thing?
That.
This?
Yes.
My drawing?
I was curious how you were going to navigate that. That was pretty good.
You noticed capital letters.
Yeah, that's totally
that's
key.
What
it was.
I'm going to talk about one more thing, and then we're going to take a quick break. A few minutes. I know you guys don't like breaks, but it is what I'm going to. We got to have breaks. I know people are already starting to fall asleep. I know. I'm tired, right? That's why people fall asleep. Very few people like wake up in the morning, but I'm totally rested, and just fall asleep. Unless I'm narcoleptic. One more point. We're going to take a quick break. Professed or actual majority. That's just a complicated way of saying, are we really talking about, when we talk about something being normal because most people do it, is it really most people or is it the loudest people? Is it the people with power or money, right? And, you know, when we talk about what is appropriate in a culture, lots of things can establish the normal in a culture that aren't really what we're talking about when we're talking about the normal in a culture. And so we have to be really, really careful about that idea of what really is normal and what isn't. Is it tied to our cultural mores tied to religion in a group of people, tied to the ruling class? When we talk about sort of like Nazi Germany. It's an interesting example, only because Ruth Benedict, who you're going to read, and she's a firm believer in moral relativism. She's the first read you're going to do over the course of the homework this week. Ruth Benedict wrote her sort of most famous paper in 1934, just as sort of the Hitler and Nazism is rising to power in Germany. And she is a strong proponent of this idea that different cultures establish their own moral rules, and that you can't judge one from the other. And then you've got, at the same time, sort of ironically, these horrible, horrible things happening in Germany. And they're not as, I mean, at that stage, Hitler still has a way to go to be as horrible as he ends up being. But still, there was some pretty clear racism, religious intolerance, homophobia, some pretty bad things going on in Germany, even before we start talking about death camps. And so it's just a little interesting that this is happening at the same time. But my point is, talk about professed or actual morality, majority, I'm talking about a different thing than this, actually. I don't think, in fact, I'd put money on the fact that most German people didn't really feel the way that Hitler did. Right? And so you've got this example of the power, the authority, establishing the cultural norms of that society, when in fact, most of the society probably didn't feel exactly the same way that he did, or even close to as strongly as he did, or want to take the steps that he did. So what is the actual morality? What is the more what are the mores of that culture? Are they Hitler's? Are they the people's? Are they somewhere in between? Are they something totally different? It's really hard to tell sometimes when cultures can be warped by either the majority, right, as we see in this country all the time, because the majority of people are middle class white people, right, which affects a whole lot of other people in weird ways, or when we're talking about a minority in power establishing the rules. And then how do we figure out what is the actual customs of and culture of that group? It's hard. It's messed up. It's challenging. Take a couple minutes. Go get some caffeine, everybody. We'll start in 10 minutes.